money to go there, Bill. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. Well, Paul and Silas thought they was lost. The dungeon shook and the chains came on. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on.
Powerful are wrong. We've got to stand and sing this song. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Children of Abraham living in fear. All God's children should draw near. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on.
Hold on. Hold on.
Walking with me, and every step I heard liberty. Though he's fallen, come a million behind.
Glory, hallelujah, gonna make it this time. No easy walk to freedom. No easy walk to freedom. shall be free. That's how we're gonna make history.
Across the ocean, the blood's running warm. I hear it coming, it's a thunder and storm. Just like we lived it, you know that it's true.
Now we have a dollar, gonna rock it with you. No easy road to freedom.
No,
no easy road to freedom. Keep on walking and we shall be free. That's how we're gonna make history.
In our land,
not so long ago, we lived the struggle, and that's how we'll know.
Slavery abolished from the freedom's call. Keep on walking and apartheid will fall. No easy walk to freedom. No easy walk to freedom. Keep on walking and you shall be free. That's how we're gonna make history.
Oh, bread for the body, there's got to be. But the soul will die without liberty.
Pray for the day when the struggle is past. Freedom for all, free at last, free at last. No easy walk to freedom.
No,
no easy walk to freedom. Keep on walking and we shall be free. That's how we're gonna make history.
Oh, no easy walk to freedom. Oh, no easy walk
to freedom. Keep on walking and we shall be free. That's how we're gonna change.
Good morning. Welcome to the Community Church of Chapel Hill Unitarian Universalist. I'm Larry Ross, a member of the Worship Associates Ministry. I especially want to welcome any visitors or newcomers to our church and to call your attention to the special note for you. Welcome guests and newcomers on the back side of the order of service. I would also like to welcome those of you attending online. We forget about our online folks, but we don't forget about you, because this is for you. Lyrics to the hymns may be found on the live stream screen, and a complete order of service is available on the link in Sunday email and on the church website. Whoever you are, whomever you love, however you've arrived at this beloved place, you are welcome here. As a congregation, we are requiring masks to be worn at this service, the 9:30 service, while masks are optional at the 11:15 service. Our religious education program is requiring masks in all their program spaces. Masks are optional during the in-person Sunday social held immediately following the service. The online Sunday social is hosted by Rachel Rose and will be held at 1 o'clock. The Zoom link is in the weekly announcements and the Sunday morning email. So this would be a good time to turn off your cell phones or set them on airplane mode so that we may maintain a worshipful service. This morning we have an announcement for Share the Plate about the Nature Conservancy, and Al Howlett will be talking to you about it. Al?
Good Good morning. My name is Al Howlett, and I am speaking on behalf of ECO, the church's environmental group. ECO's Share the Plate for this year's Earth Month is the Nature Conservancy's project to restore areas in North Carolina's coastal plain called peatlands. We are pleased to welcome two guest experts this morning. Please stand. Genevieve Joseph is from the Nature Conservancy, and Kathy Starkweather leads a Carol Woods retirement community group that also supports this conservancy project. We hope you will visit with them at Eco Tabling after the service to learn more. Thank you. Did you know that the Earth's peatlands store as much carbon as all of the Earth's trees? Long ago, North Carolina peatlands were drained for farming and forestry. When dry, peatlands release carbon into the air. Carbon is the leading cause of global warming. When peatlands catch fire, which happens all too often, they release even more carbon, and those fires are often hard to distinguish. Fortunately, there is a remedy: re-wetting the peatlands, and that's exactly what the Nature Conservancy is doing. In addition to providing incredible carbon benefits, channeling water to re-wet peatlands reduces flooding in farming communities downstream and improves wildlife habitat. You can help the Nature Conservancy restore North Carolina peatlands and keep that carbon in the ground. More financial support will hasten this important work tied to the climate crisis. ECO encourages you to contribute as you can to today's Share the Plate to help restore our carbon, our coastal peatlands. You can give cash, a check payable to community church with peatlands in the memo line, or use the QR code to donate online. Thank you.
Please join us in singing the opening hymn, Rise If You Are Able. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, and Glenn is gonna introduce it.
Yeah, so if this mic is coming on. So I asked Reverend Thom if we could do this song, because I don't know if anybody saw, there's a viral video this week of one of the Justins from Tennessee, who was temporarily removed from the legislature, singing at an airport with Joan Baez. And I thought it was a wonderful way to just express the generational fight, and also to show that that song is moving on to a new generation. So I thought we would do it today in honor of that. And the words aren't in your order of service, so I'll just give them to you. It's basically, I'm gonna call out, it's what's called a zipper song, so I'll call out the new word each verse. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me. I'm gonna keep on a walking, keep on a talking, marching up to freedom land. And then I'll just say segregation, and then we'll do a different word each time. And the Bluegrass Battleship's hopefully gonna help me out. Gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Gonna keep on a walking, keep on a talking, marching up to freedom land. Ain't gonna let segregation, ain't gonna let segregation turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let segregation turn me around. I'm gonna keep on a walking, keep on a-talking, marching up the freedom land. Ain't gonna let racism, ain't gonna let racism turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let racism turn me around. I'm gonna keep on a-walking, keep on a-talking, marching up the freedom land. Ain't gonna let no hatred, ain't gonna let no hatred turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let no hatred turn me around. I'm gonna keep on a-walking, keep on a-talking, marching up the freedom land. Injustice, ain't gonna let injustice turn me around. Turn, harmonize if you want. Turn me around, ain't gonna let injustice turn me around. I'm gonna keep on a-walking, keep on a-talking, walking up the freedom. Here's one for today. No, ain't gonna let no jail cell. One, two. Ain't gonna let no jail cell turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let no jail cell turn me around. Gonna keep on a-walking, keep on a-talking, marching up to freedom. Ain't gonna let nobody, ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm gonna keep on a-marching, keep on a-talking, marching up to freedom land.
The call to worship. Come into this church. Come into this church and let us commit ourselves to the type of church we will be. Let us strive not to be a bunker church with thick walls cutting us off from the world around us. No, let us be a beacon reaching out to the wider world, showing the way towards the world we want to see. Let us strive not to be the place of magical thinking, where we hope things change all on their own. No, let us be a working church, where we show up and actively work for the change we want to see in the world. Let us not strive to be a fearful church. Let us not shy from challenge, discomfort, and tension. Let us be a church that proclaims bold truths, dreams bold dreams, and pursues justice boldly. Come into this church. Let us worship together. Please join me in saying the words for the chalice lighting, written in your order of service. Power without love is reckless and abusive. And love without power is sentimental and anemic. Power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice, and justice at its best is power correcting everything that stands against love.
This song is called Beautiful Fool. It's written by Don Henry, and Kathy Matea recorded a gorgeous version of it. It's all about the love and courage that Martin Luther King showed the world.
Mm-hmm.
that you were appointed by some higher nearly mortal, your plans were unaffordable. No one wants to pay for love.
Oh, you beautiful fall, swimming upstream, kicking up waves. Dreams weren't meant to come true. That's why they call them dreams. Oh, you beautiful fool.
Walter Cronkite preempted Disney one night, and all us kids were so upset. We thought that you were a trouble instigator, marching through our TV set.
Oh, you beautiful fool, swimming upstream, kicking up waves. Dreams weren't meant to come true. That's why we call them dreams. Oh, you beautiful fool.
To fight without a fist, all human instinct puzzles this. How dare you threaten our existence? Mahatma Gandhi, Jesus Christ, history repeats itself so nice. Consistently we are resistant to love. I saw you on the black and white with blacks and whites applauding you. I saw you on another time without a sign of life in you.
Oh, you beautiful fool, swimming upstream, kicking up waves. Dreams weren't meant to come true. That's why we call them dreams. Oh, you beautiful fool. Oh, you beautiful fool.
Thank you, Glenn. Each week we hold in our service a time for sharing the joys and the sorrows that we bring with us into this church community. It's during this time, if you've come with either a personal joy or a personal sorrow to share, you're invited to come forward, place a stone in our water bowl, say your name, and briefly share your joy or your sorrow. Let us enter into this time of tenderness and trust. Are there any joys and sorrows this morning?
Hi,
I'm Eileen Riggin, and I have a great joy to share today. My sister Mary, who's very dear to me, has finished her chemo treatment. Her cancer was caught early, and she has done extraordinarily well. And I'm just like breathing.
We're a quiet bunch this morning. A final stone is placed for all the joys and sorrows that we hold in our hearts that were not spoken. I invite us to take a few moments and join with me in the spirit of prayer and meditation. Spirit of life, source of our being and our becoming, we gather in this beautiful spring morning, surrounded by the blooming of flowers, the greening of trees, the earth awakening. We gather on this Earth Day morning, or this Earth Month morning, contemplating our place in this world, committing ourselves to live with greater responsibility. We gather this morning amidst a world hurting with pain, the pain of violence and war, discrimination, and rights that are threatened. We come into this time to reconnect with the courage of our convictions, our willingness to lead lives of change making. We come with the joys and the sorrows of our lives, the blessings we enjoy, the challenges we face, the grief we hold in our hearts. In the silence we now hold, let us be surrounded by our own prayers and mingle those with the prayers of this community and this world. I invite you to be still with me for a few moments. Amen, and blessed be. And I invite you to join in singing our meditation hymn, It Is Over My Head, in the gray hymnal, and we will remain seated as we sing together.
This morning's reading comes from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's Jr.'s letter from a Birmingham jail, which he wrote in a jail cell in Birmingham after he was jailed for marching without a permit while leading a civil rights march. The letter was written exactly 60 years ago today. Dr. King wrote, I am in Birmingham because injustice is here. Moreover, I am cognizant of the interrelatedness of all communities and states. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Never again can we afford to live with the narrow, provincial, outside agitator idea.
Anyone who lives inside the United States can never be considered an outsider anywhere within its bounds. You deplore the demonstrations taking place in Birmingham. But your statement, I am sorry to say, fails to express a similar concern for the conditions that brought about the demonstrations. I am sure that none of you would want to rest content with the superficial kind of social analysis that deals merely with the effects and does not grapple with the underlying causes. It is unfortunate that demonstrations are taking place in Birmingham, but it is even more unfortunate that the city's white power structure left the Negro community with no alternative. We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. Frankly, I have yet to engage in a direct action campaign that was well timed in view of those who have not suffered unduly from the disease of segregation. For years now, I have heard the word wait. It rings in the ear of every Negro with piercing familiarity. This wait has almost always meant never. We must come to see with one of our distinguished jurists that justice too long delayed is justice denied. Never before have I written so long a letter. I'm afraid it is much too long to take your precious time. I can assure you that it would have been much shorter if I had been writing from a comfortable desk. But what else can one do when he is alone in a narrow jail cell other than write long letters, think long thoughts, and pray long prayers? We now take an offering that allows us to exercise our generosity of spirit that will support this church and its many ministries. It's Share the Plate Sunday. So for Share the Plate Sunday, please use the QR code in your order of service and put STP in a memo line if you are donating in the check, a memo line. And we will now.
Come round by my side, and I'll sing you a song. Sing it so softly, it'll do no one wrong. On Birmingham Sunday, the blood ran like wine, and the choirs kept singing of freedom. That cold autumn morning, no, I saw the sun, and Addie Mae Collins, her number was one. At an old Baptist church, there was no need to run, and the choirs kept singing of freedom. Now the clouds, they were gray, and the autumn wind blew, and Dennis McNair brought the number to two. The falcon of death was a creature they knew, and the choirs kept singing of freedom. Church, it was crowded, but no one could see that Cynthia Wesley's dark number was three. Her prayers and her feelings would shame you and me, and the choirs kept singing of freedom. Young Carol Robertson entered the door, and the number her killers had given was four. She asked for a blessing, but asked for no more, and the choirs kept singing of freedom. On Birmingham Sunday, a noise shook the ground, and people all over the earth turned around. For no one recalled a more cowardly sound, and the choirs kept singing of freedom. Now the Sunday has come, and the Sunday has gone, and we can't do much more than to sing you this song. But sing it so loudly, you better sing along. And the choirs kept singing of freedom.
So last April, I joined a group of clergy, representatives from the NAACP and other justice organizations here in Chapel Hill, humanities professors, and staff of the Chapel Hill Public Library in planning an event or a series of events to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the Freedom Riders coming to Chapel Hill in 1947. That group had so much fun working together that this year they got back together and at the urging of James Williams set about creating a whole series of events this spring to commemorate the 60th anniversary of Dr. King's letter from a Birmingham jail. There was supposed to be a clergy walk on Good Friday that got canceled because of the torrential rain. This afternoon, there's actually going to be a reading of the entirety of King's letter from a Birmingham jail at the Chapel Hill Public Library. And then in May, there's going to be an event in which elected officials come together and talk about how they see King's letter as relevant today. But today, April 16th, being the to the day anniversary 60 years ago of when King began to write the letter from a Birmingham jail, I figured that I wanted to discuss it in a sermon. 60 years ago today, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. sat in a jail cell in Birmingham, Alabama, put pen to scraps of paper, and began to compose the letter from a Birmingham jail. King had come to Birmingham to join a campaign against segregation. Birmingham was one of the most segregated cities in the South, and also one of the most vicious. Public Safety Commissioner Bull Connor oversaw police blasting peaceful protesters with powerful fire hoses and sicking dogs on protesters, including children. Birmingham was known colloquially as Bombingham because black churches, businesses, and family homes were so often targeted by terrorist bombings. In September of that same year, 1963, Birmingham Sunday, a bombing at the 16th Street Baptist Church would kill four black girls between the ages of 11 and 14. On Good Friday, April 12th, 1963, King led a civil rights march and was quickly arrested. He remained in jail through the Easter weekend and into the following week. And in jail, he received word of an open letter that had been written by eight white religious leaders in Birmingham. The eight white clergy who wrote the letter included a Jewish rabbi, a Catholic priest, and clergy from the Episcopalian, Methodist, Presbyterian, and Baptist churches. These clergy were all moderates. They held positions personally as well as publicly that were critical of segregation and especially critical of the violence that plagued their city. The letter that they wrote was entitled A Call for Unity, and this letter criticized King and the civil rights movement. They called King an outside agitator. They called the plans for marches and protests unwise and untimely. They worried that civil rights marches and demonstrations would provoke violence. And they pointed to a newly elected city council and favored that segregation be opposed through negotiation and compromise and legal challenges as they worked their way through the courts. Their letter was a mess. Was full of paternalism, victim blaming, gradualism, and treated the feelings and the comfort of Birmingham's white population as more important than the human rights of African Americans. In response, King composed his letter from a Birmingham jail, which explained the theological, moral, and strategic principles of nonviolent civil disobedience. And his letter also strongly criticized the white moderates of Birmingham and the white church. I want to read a couple passages from King's letter that are perhaps the most challenging. King wrote, "I must make two honest confessions to you, my Jewish and Christian brothers. First, I must confess that over the past few years, I have been gravely disappointed with the white moderate. I have almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in his stride toward freedom is not the white citizen's counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, 'I agree with you in the goal that you seek, but I cannot agree with your methods of direct action,' who who paternalistically believes he can set the timetable for another man's freedom, who lives by a mythical concept of time and who constantly advises the Negro to wait for a more convenient season. Shallow understanding from people of goodwill is far more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. Lukewarm acceptance is much more bewildering than outright rejection. And secondly, King continued, I must honestly reiterate that I've been disappointed with the church. When I was suddenly catapulted into the leadership of the bus protest in Montgomery, Alabama a few years ago, I felt we would be supported by the white church. I felt that the white ministers, priests, and rabbis of the South would be among our strongest allies. Instead, some have been outright opponents, refusing to understand the freedom movement and misrepresenting its leaders. All too many others have been more cautious than courageous and have remained silent behind the anesthetizing security of stained glass windows. In the midst of a mighty struggle to rid our nation of racial and economic injustice, I have heard many ministers say those are social issues with which the gospel has no real concern. And I've watched many churches commit themselves to a completely otherworldly religion, which makes a strange and unbiblical distinction between body and soul, between the sacred and the secular. The words of Martin Luther King. I have to admit, it's kind of hard to write a sermon about the letter from Birmingham Jail and not just read as much of the letter as I can in 20 minutes and then sort of say, come back and hear the rest next week. But I want to follow a few, maybe three strands of thought related to King's letter from a Birmingham jail. I want to talk about the letter's relevance in society today. I want to talk about how the letter speaks to the church today. And I want to talk about some of the religious insights that the letter from a Birmingham jail continues to impart today. First, even though the letter from a Birmingham jail was written fully six decades ago, it still speaks powerfully to the times in which we live. Parts of the letter seem like they may have been written just yesterday. When King talks in a portion of the letter about police brutality and the unfair, unequal, and violent treatment of African Americans by law enforcement, he might as well have been writing today in these times. The struggle for voting rights that King helped lead in Selma in 1964 continues even today. King writes in his letter, "Who can say that the legislature of Alabama, which set up the state's segregation laws, was democratically elected? Throughout Alabama, all sorts of devious methods are used to prevent African Americans from becoming registered voters. Can any law enacted under such circumstances be considered democratically structured?" Today, voting rights are very much under attack, with all sorts of devious methods being used to make it harder for Black people and young people to participate in democracy. Today, gerrymandering has resulted in legislative bodies around the country being constituted with a minority controlling the majority. And we might ask those same questions. Can any law enacted under such circumstances be considered democratically structured? It is this same gerrymandered supermajority that protesters a week and a half ago in Nashville, Tennessee, led by three state elected representatives, went to challenge gun laws in the state of Tennessee, leading for those state representatives to be voted out of office on Good Friday, 2023, by an assembly that does not meet the qualifications for democracy. The letter is still relevant today. In reading King's letter from Birmingham Jail today, I also find myself confronted and discomforted by his words about the church. I've traveled the length and the breadth of Alabama, Mississippi, and all the other southern states, King writes. On sweltering summer days and crisp autumn mornings, I've looked at the South's beautiful churches with their lofty spires pointing heavenward. I've beheld the impressive outlines of her massive religious education buildings. Over and over, I have found myself asking, what kind of people worship here? Who is their God? So often the contemporary church is weak, ineffectual, with an uncertain sound. So often it is the arch defender of the status quo. Far from being disturbed by the presence of the church, the power structure of the average community is consoled by the church's silent and often even vocal sanction of the way things are. I sometimes wonder about those eight congregations in Birmingham, whose clergy wrote an open letter against King coming to Birmingham. Like, what are those congregations doing with their service this morning, I wonder? Right? How do they tell their history? There's a certain good fortune in being the minister of this church. Because if we were to ask, what were we doing as a church in 1961, 1962, 1963, when young black high school students and young activists and white college students were holding sit-ins at restaurants and protesting in front of movie theaters to try to integrate Chapel Hill? I'm so fortunate that I get to actually say, well, back then, our minister, Charlie Jones, was meeting with students and helping them organize their activism, and meeting with town leaders, putting pressure on them to end segregation. And one of our most active members, Dan Pollitt, was providing pro bono legal services to those arrested for protesting. And two more of our active members, Joe and Lucy Straley, were helping to organize the protests as well. But even I can say that without having to actually reckon. Being Unitarian Universalist often means that I and that we have the ability to speak out clearly and unequivocally on issues of justice. I remember when I lived in Kansas and I would show up at pro-choice days of activism. There would be, among the clergy that showed up, there would be me. There would be a retired Presbyterian minister, a retired UCC minister, and another retired Episcopalian minister. And I would look and I would say, what? They said, well, we couldn't do this when we were actually working. It would have been too much risk. And I said, oh, well, it would have been the most risky thing I could do wouldn't be not to show up. I'd really hear it from my people if I didn't show up. It can also be tempting, though, to avoid self-criticism. And not ask the questions that we should be asking ourselves. Why are we not louder? Why do we not do more to challenge the status quo? What greater discomfort should we be leaning into? What tensions should we be creating? The religious idea that I take away from King's letter from a Birmingham jail is this idea of holy tension. Holy tension. He writes, nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and foster such a tension that a community which has constantly refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issue. My citing the creation of tension as the part of the work of the nonviolent resistor may sound rather shocking, but I may confess that I am not afraid of the word tension. I've earnestly opposed violent tension, but there is a type of constructive, nonviolent tension which is necessary for growth. There is a type of constructive, nonviolent tension which is necessary for growth. Ask, where in your life do you encounter that tension, that holy tension? Do you find it in your work, in your community, with your family, with your church, with your faith, with your neighbors? Where are you in tension? It is too often, I think, our tendency to shy away from tension, to see tension as uncomfortable, to see tension as a place where we don't want to be, to move to kind of release that tension without asking what it's teaching us. And so my charge to us, my spiritual charge to us, is to embrace tension, to recognize that in those places of tension we find a lesson to learn, a necessary challenge to ourselves, and to lean into those moments. My second charge to you is to, if you've not done it already, to take the time to read and meditate on the letter from Birmingham Jail, to ask how it speaks to us today, and how we might make its dream, which continues to elude us, into a reality. Amen. Blessed be. And our closing hymn of the morning is number 151. I wish I knew how. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join in singing out loudly.
I could be like a Benediction.
it feels to be free. Then I'd sing, 'cause I know how it feels to be free.
Please join me in the words for extinguishing the chalice flame. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts again. And before we sing the closing shalom, I would like to thank those who contributed to making this worshipful service this morning. Please join hands or cross your arms and sing shalom. The words are in the order of service.
Shalom, my high friend, shalom, my high friend, shalom, shalom. We'll meet again.